Part two of our series, we are getting into the design of our wood diaphragm. We're going through a full design example today, step by step, working through both the NDS and the 716. You're really gonna love it. But why are diaphragms so important? What's the big deal about it? Well, they're part of your lateral force resisting system. They're what I like to call the horizontal lateral elements of your building. And then something like your shear walls or your brace frames or, you know, anything else in between, those are what I consider your vertical lateral elements of your building. So they make sure, in short, that your building stays in place under any type of lateral loading event, and most of the time that is due to a seismic event or wind loading event. If you're a new engineer, if you're a practicing engineer, it's something you can't dodge. Subscribe if you haven't, like the content if you like what you're seeing here today, and let's get started. I'm just gonna scroll back up quickly to show you. You can pause this if you want to suck in all that information, but this is everything that's given. One quick thing I do want to clarify that I didn't on the first episode, I guess you can call it, is that this is designing a structure for seismic requirements, not wind requirements. So we're doing some extra things here, or it's just some different things to satisfy the seismic design. One quick thing I want to do first is determine that our aspect ratios for our diaphragm are acceptable. To do that, we need to head over to the NDS, specifically the special design provisions for wind and seismic. So I'll see you over there. That lands us in section 4.2.4, which title says it right there. If we jot down to the table, maximum diaphragm aspect ratios for horizontal or sloped diaphragms. Ours is horizontal. And you very, very simplistically, you go down, check your diaphragm sheathing type. We are wood structural panel and we're blocked. We're fully blocked the whole way, which means that we get a maximum aspect ratio for length to width of 4:1. So A is going to be equal to 256 feet divided by 120 feet. And again, to reiterate, we are designing in our shear walls and our diaphragm and everything right now for this series in the north-south direction. So any demand is being applied to the structure in the north-south direction. So ultimately, say our diaphragm were to deform under loading, it would get this kind of shape going on here. So our aspect is gonna be W, which is 256, and our length, which is 120. Thus, our aspect ratio is 2.1, which is less than 4. So we know that we are okay and we are within the requirements for aspect ratio of our diaphragm. Good to go. Next, I'm gonna jump through quickly and give us basically the weight of our structure. I'm not gonna go through it step by step. I have previous videos going over that. That's not what we're here today for, right? So the seismic mass of our structure in the north-south direction, WPX, is equal to 1,064 kips. Some of our seismic parameters, SDS and SD1, equal the following. Those were given to us in the problem statement. We have a response modification factor equal to 5, and this is based on your lateral resisting system, which is a special reinforced concrete shear walls. That gets you an R equal to 5, an omega equal to 2.5, and a C sub D equal to 5. We'll use that stuff scattered throughout. We calculate that our approximate fundamental period is equal to 0.22 seconds. T sub S is calculated to be 0.57. T sub A is less than T sub S, which means that C sub S, our seismic design coefficient, can be calculated as 0.165. Again, I ran through that. You can do that by hand based on the information given to you from the problem. I have previous videos where we go through step by step through the code in order to solve all of that and determine all of that. But again, not while we're here today. We want to get straight to that diaphragm design, not waste your time. But why am I giving this to you? Because ultimately we need to determine the force that's going to be acting on your lateral system so that you can then make sure that the capacity of your diaphragm is greater than the demand acting on your diaphragm. So we need that demand, unfortunately. From all the info given, we can now determine the seismic design load that is acting on our diaphragm. And this is gonna be strength level, so LRFD. That can be denoted as FPX being equal to 176 kips. And this is from ASCE 716, equation 12
10-1.
So this is your diaphragm force. This is not the lateral force acting on your structure. This is specifically the diaphragm force. They are different. From this, you also need to determine your minimum seismic force acting on your diaphragm, which is given with another equation. But this ends up also equaling basically 176 kips. They're both very, very close, but that is not always the case. It's just a coincidence here today. Same thing, the 716, and that's equation 1210-2. And over here, I'm just gonna say LRFD. E sub H is equal to rho QE, and QE is equal to FPX in this case. So we determined in our first episode that rho is equal to 1.0, and QE, we found out, is equal to FPX, which is equal to 176 kips, and that's strength levels, so that's LRFD. So for LRFD, the equation is 1.0 E sub H, which would be equal to 176 kips. But wood design, we always like to stay in ASD. So we are going to convert from LRFD to ASD right now. So you could technically use either LRFD or ASD when you are designing your diaphragm, because within the special design provisions for wind and seismic, the tables have capacities for your diaphragm in both LRFD and ASD, but I've always done wood in ASD. Leave a comment down below if you're someone who prefers LRFD, but personally, by me, I think they just introduce more factors in order to run LRFD calculations, and it can get just a little bit more confusing. But that's just my opinion. I'd love to hear yours. All right, so 123 kips. This is gonna get plugged in right there. So I'm gonna scroll up a little bit, hopefully get my fat head out of the way. Now we're gonna distribute it, and I'll go green, which is 256 feet, so that we can ultimately get a reaction. We'll call it A, and reaction B along here. I'm gonna go blue, and I'm gonna draw my shear diagram, which would look something like this. Not bad, it would be perfect, right? The maximum V, so V rec, because we're ASD now, which is the same on both sides. We're treating this diaphragm like a simply supported beam with, you could think about it like a pin here and a roller right here, and you're just spanning the distance. So this is just, again, a simply supported beam with, in green here, a uniformly distributed load along that beam. Well, first, let's determine W, which is our uniformly distributed load. W is equal to 123.2 kips divided by 256 feet. 400, and we're gonna round up, 482 pounds per lineal foot. So I've also multiplied by 1,000 to go from kips to pounds, all right? Now, to find V rec, that's equal to WL over 2 for a simply supported beam with a uniform load on it. My tip, go to the AISC steel manual, and they have all of those loading charts for all of your simple beams and simple loading diagrams. It's a great spot to go. That's the equation that we would use. And I know you might be saying, hey, why did we divide in order to find W just to multiply again to get the reaction? It's an extra step, you don't need to do that. I'm trying to kind of not simplify, I'm trying to make it very visually easy to understand how these forces are being distributed and kind of how we're analyzing this thing, but you don't have to do that step, I get it. 61.6 kips, and you know what, I'm just gonna round that up to 62 kips. Now to get the line load for your shear demand along your shear wall, we need to divide VREC by the length of the shear wall that's gonna be resisting that load. If we go back up here, in our problem, we know that a shear wall, if I go yellow highlighter, is the full 120 feet. So there are no openings, there's no anything, it's just freaking reinforced, special reinforced concrete shear walls for that whole 120 feet. We'll call it Q1 is gonna be equal to 62 kips divided by 120 feet. That gets us a demand line load of 517 pounds per foot. And again, this is ASD. So let's box that. And you know what? We're gonna fine tune this a little bit. So we could specify a diaphragm type that would satisfy the worst case shear line load, which is at the ends, like we've just calculated here. But if I scroll up here, as we get closer to the middle of our diaphragm, based on looking on our blue shear diagram, you can see that the shear capacity, or the shear demand at the ends, as it moves towards the middle, gets less and less until there is no shear demand at the midpoint of our diaphragm. So we can, what we can do to optimize this is, what do I wanna do here? I'll keep it in red, I'll do dashed. Is we can choose to split up our diaphragm into zones of our diaphragm, and each zone we will design its own specific nailing pattern based on the capacity that it needs to resist the demand in that zone. And we'll just do two. So we'll have zone A, which will be at both ends, and then zone B will be in the middle. So we're gonna actually determine two different diaphragm types, all right? And what we'll say is zone A is located 48 feet from our shear wall, and that's both sides. Because if you look back up in our detailing that was provided to us, you see that we have glue lamp beams at 8 feet on center. So at 48 feet, that's a far enough distance where the shear demand can drop significantly to where we could downsize our diaphragm type. But at 48 feet, that is divisible by 8, which means that that zone will land on one of these glue lambs, so we can easily transition from the sheathing panels from one type to another. But what do we need from this? So what I'm going to switch, instead of Q1, we'll call this QA, because that's the shear demand for zone A. For zone B, we need to find that next. And all we need to do is interpolate. We know that zone A ends 48 feet from the edge of our shear walls. And we know that the midpoint right here is 256 divided by 2 and then subtract 48 feet. That leaves us with another 80 feet. Now, the shear diagram is linear, that slope of the line, our blue diagram here, which means that we can just interpolate linearly. QB equals QA times 80 feet over 128 feet. That equals 323 pounds per foot. And again, that's ASD. Let's box that one also. And this kind of gives us the cleaned up following. There we go, a little summation of everything that we just went through visually for you. Well, we've already been given a sheathing type in our design example. So what we really need to do is determine the nail spacing. And you can do that by heading to the diaphragm lateral tables that are located in the NDS in the special design provisions for wind and seismic. I know it's freaking mouthful, which is in chapter 4. I think it's tables 4.2. So let's head over there now. Just as I suspected, 4.2, and it's gonna be table A, because that is for, if we look at this subtitle, blocked wood structural panel diaphragms, which is us. Now, one quick thing I wanna mention, and this is a tip from one of my shorts, if you have been dipping into those a little bit, is that pay attention to the main title. So this is a wood frame diaphragm. And I know you're saying, well, the title is says diaphragm right there, and I'm, you know, designing a diaphragm. Easy. The only reason I bring this up is that these capacity tables look very, very similar for shear wall design as well. So you can get confused, and they're right after one another. So they're very close within the code and they look alike. So pay attention always to that title. I know I've been tripped up before by accident where I thought I was looking at diaphragms and I've realized, oh crap, this is for shear wall. So we are structural one panels. We're using 8D nails. This is, again, given to us in the problem statement. Our panel thickness is 3/8, and I know that we have nominal widths of 3 inches all around based on the subframe that we have to nail the diaphragm to. We'll find ourselves in the seismic panel, not the wind panel, so we're not looking over here. And then we're gonna scroll across, and we know that we need to satisfy a demand in zone A of what, 517 pounds, I believe it was, per lineal foot. So these values, V sub S, as you can see, their units are in PLF. So that's what we want. That's how we're comparing this. This is ASD capacities. So we have our demand is in the right, load factors, and we're good to go. Now we just need to determine. We are going to assume all cases. So you have all these different panel configurations and nailing configurations. We are not going to justify a specific type that the contractor needs to adhere to. So we need to make sure that we cover all the different cases. And by doing that, you see that we have two rows here, here and here. The first one being nail spacing at diaphragm boundaries, all cases, at continuous panel edges parallel to load, so case 3 and 4, and as well as cases 5 and 6. We're gonna need a 2.5 inch nail spacing, which would get us 1200 PLF. You're looking at that and you're going, why 1200? We only need to satisfy 517. Hang on a second. And then for every other case, so cases 1, 2, 3, and 4, it only needs to be 4 inch nail spacing. So we're gonna use those two requirements and we're gonna justify where that spacing needs to be on the panels. All right, let's head back and plug that info in. Zone A for diaphragm boundaries, we need 2.5 inch nail spacing, as well as continuous panel edges. We need 2.5 nail spacing. For other edges, we need 4 inches. For field nailing, that's typically 12 inch spacing. And we got a capacity, we said, of 1200 PLF. Well, there's one thing that you need to pay attention to, and that is a factor that you need to apply based on the NDS requirements. Let's jump back real fast and show you. Always check out your footnotes, and the first one is what we're gonna be looking at here, which is nominal unit shear capacities shall be adjusted in accordance with 4.2.3 to determine the ASD allowable unit shear capacity and LRFD factored unit resistance. And if you read through, you will see we need to apply an ASD reduction factor of 2.0. And for LRFD, if you're doing that, you need to apply a factor of 0.8. So that 1200 PLF is now divided by 2, which turns out to be 600 PLF for your capacity. Now that 600 is much closer to that demand of 517 PLF. So we're still good to go, but that's the reasoning.
So our capacity is now 600 PLF for zone A.
So that's all the requirements for zone A. Let's go back and get zone B quick and fill it in. Same type of sheathing, same type of nails, and everything in between. It's just now determining what our nail spacing needs to be for that zone, which has a lesser shear demand.
That falls us into this territory, lands us at 800.
So 4 inch where we had 2.5, and then 6 inch where we had 4.
We have a capacity of 400 PLF. And then just for good measure, let's put in our demand ASD, 517 PLF and 323 PLF.
And simply put, that is how you design a wood diaphragm. Hope you like it. This is part 2 of our multi-part series on this design of this structure.